Thank you for putting the live on YouTube. Yes, thank you everyone for being here tonight. First of all, we'd like to introduce, I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Nadia Dalai as the moderator for today's webinar. We would like to welcome you to the first pre-event webinar for the Council of the Islamic Conference of Health Ministers, or IECHM, with today's topic of regulating health policies to mitigate the emerging of new global scale contagious diseases. First of all, to start off of our agenda for tonight, we would like to invite Ms. Astrid Nadia Rizkita to give the report of the Model OIC Indonesia country as the Model OIC Indonesia country coordinator. To Ms. Astrid, time is yours.
Thank you, moderator, for giving me the floor. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Ladies and gentlemen, respected speakers, our seniors, colleagues. I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Astrid Nadia Rizkita. I'm the Model OIC Indonesia Country Coordinator and also the Secretary General of OIC Indonesia. We'd like to thank you for your participation and your attendance in this pre-event webinar of the very first virtual Model OIC conference held by the OIC of Indonesia. And this event not only serves as a pre-event to the conference that will be held on the 15th to 16th of August 2020, but also for us to be able to interact with experts on the relevant field in this occasion regarding the Islamic Conference of Health Minister, or ICHM. With that, we'd like to thank our honorable speakers, Mr. Ferry Rahman from PBID, as the Deputy Secretary General, and also Her Excellency Dr. Putih Sari as the member of Commission 9 of DPR RI. And I'd like to also thank the dedicated team, Madiasta, Faisal, and Harvin as the project coordinator of this virtual conference for making this event happen into fruition. And also the fellow colleagues of OIC Indonesia. And the virtual Model OIC conference serves to be able to interact and also gather dedicated youth from university to be able to take part in capacity building by the OIC Indonesia, namely in negotiation, public speaking, and diplomatic simulation skills as well. With that, I'd also like to thank our seniors for helping making this event come into fruition, and hopefully, Mr. Tantan Taufik Lubis as the Vice President of ICYF and representative of Asia region of ICYF, also Chairman of Indonesia National Council and Head of Advisory Board, for his relentless support to us throughout the planning of the event. With that, I'd like to again thank the speakers and also the participants. This is actually broadcasted live on YouTube, and to all the viewers, to please interact with the speakers and make use of this very valuable opportunity. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you to Ms. Astrid for your opening report. Next, we would like to invite Mr. Tantan Taufik Lubis as the Vice President of the Islamic Cooperation Youth Forum, or ICYF, also the Chairman of Indonesia National Youth Council and the Head of Advisory Board of OIC Youth Indonesia, to give his opening speech. To Mr. Tantan Taufik Lubis, the floor is yours.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. You can hear me?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. Yeah, we hear you.
Inna alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nasta'kfiruh. Wa na'udhu billahi min syururi anfusina wa min sayyati amalina. Mayyadihillahu falamudillalah. Wa mayyudillahu falahadiyalah. Your Excellencies, the Member of Parliament, Dr. Putih Sari, and also honorable speakers, Dr. Ferry Rahman, it is also my brother, the young activist, the former of Himpunan Mahasiswa Islam, LKMI Cabang Jakarta. Thank you for to be here with us. First of all, I would like to thank also to the committee from OIC Youth Indonesia who has giving opportunity to me as the ASEAN representative of ICYF to giving a welcoming speech here, not only for touching my brother sister, but also to explain a little bit of OIC Youth model or model OIC that already established since 14 years in the Islamic Cooperation Youth Forum, and also in Indonesia already established since last year. My brother sister run OIC member countries. As we know, the model OIC is the academic simulation of the organization of Islamic cooperation that I'm at educating the young Muslim, the participant, about current trend to know about the current issue in theory and the practice of international relation, to make and to know the effective communication, and to know also about the multilateral diplomacy and bilateral diplomacy, and all about the international relation. Model OIC also have the vision to enhancing Muslim youth skill, especially the young leader, and also the capability of the Islamic young generation for the sake of the revitalizing a leading of Muslim Ummah. The model OIC also have the mission promoting belonging and loyalty to the Islamic civilization, and enhancing a participant in intercultural skill, critical thinking, atau kita sering menyebutnya sebagai membentuk generasi muda yang memiliki daya kritis yang tinggi, as well as promoting a platform for youth, intellectual, and to meet together and discuss the problem, the current problem right now in the international issue. Hadirin yang berbahagia, bahwa model OIC ini sudah establish belasan tahun lamanya di ICYF dan sudah dilaksanakan di berbagai negara, khususnya di 57 negara anggota OKI yang sangat memiliki tujuan yang sangat bagus untuk mempertajam kemampuan kecerdasan intelektual para generasi muda Indonesia yang memang di area diplomatik sungguh sangat atau masih sangat minim para peminat. Tidak hanya di kaum muda, tentunya di kaum tua juga seperti ini, area internationalization adalah sesuatu yang sangat sedikit peminatnya. Tonight's already together with us, the speaker from the parliament, member of parliament, commission of nine, Dr. Putrisari, and also from ED, Indonesian Doctor Association, Dr. Ferry Rahman. Both of them is the expert in the field of healthy, and inshallah, tonight, they will explain about us, about the macro of healthy situation in the world related to the current situation during the COVID pandemic, And tonight also we will got some new knowledge, especially in the health minister meeting, because the ministerial the healthy ministerial meeting is the section, the fixed section in the OIC model that always be the first aspect that should be discussed with by the OIC member countries. Semoga malam ini kita dapat mendapatkan pencerahan dari seluruh narasumber yang insya Allah keduanya sudah expert dalam bidang kesehatan, karena dua-duanya tidak hanya dokter tapi juga aktivis muda, young aktivis yang insya Allah beliau-beliau sangat memahami denyut nadi kita sebagai aktivis muda Islam yang memang sangat haus dengan ilmu-ilmu baru dan wawasan-wawasan baru. Happy discuss to all brother sister around OIC Youth territory. Insyaallah, both speaker will give us enlightenment, aufklärung, and will be make us more clever, more smart than today. Insyaallah. Last but not least, I would like to thanks once again to the speaker, Bang Peri Rahman dan Kakak Putih Sari. Wabillahi taufik ila aqwa mitorik, wallahu wafiq ila sabilil haq. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thanks moderator. Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you to Mr. Tantan Taufik Lubis for your opening speech. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, we will be moving on to our first panel speaker for tonight. We would like to invite Dr. Putih Sari as one of the members of Commission 9 DPR RI, or the Indonesian Parliament. For everyone's information, the 9th Commission of the Indonesian Parliament is in charge of health and also employment. So without further ado, we can start with our first speaker for this panel, Dr. Putih Sari. The floor is yours. We would like to also inform all of the participants that we will also be providing an interpretation from Indonesian to English after every slide. Dr. Putih, you may begin your material.
Thank you for the invitation for me telling about the situation of the COVID-19 in Indonesia. And the update today of the COVID-19. I will the material is already to share.
It's ready to share, Doctor.
Okay, I will start first about the health policy to mitigate the emerging of the new global scale contagious disease case study, of course, on pandemic COVID-19. Next. The infectious diseases are still a public health problem that causes high morbidity and mortality and disability. So it's necessary to implement the prevention, and then the contagious disease contagious disease control is a health effort to that priorities promotive and preventive aspect aim to reducing and eliminating of the morbidity, disability, and mortality, who's limiting transmission and spread of disease so that it doesn't spread between region and between countries and has potential cause extraordinary events or outbreaks. Some as a part of the world community, of course, Indonesia committed to making effort to prevent public health emergencies that are troubling the world, including COVID-19. Next. Yeah. The Minister of Health have a regulation to prevention and to prevention of the communicable disease. Including the epidemics, is aimed to protect the community from the disease transmission, and then to decrease the morbidity, disability, and death due to communicable disease, and also reducing the social damage, culture, and economic impact of communicable disease on individual, on families, and on the communities. Next. Yeah, this is the effort to prevent, control, and eradicate in the prevention of infectious disease carry out through activities such as health promotions, and then health surveillance, control of risk factors, case finding, and then how to giving immunity to mass the delivery of the preventive drugs, and other activities that's stipulated by the Minister of Health. In a case of the prevention of the disease of outbreaks, it's necessary to take health quarantine measure, and it's already set in our law, yeah, in Undang-Undang number 6. 2018, it's include how to quarantine, isolation, and then vaccination or prophylaxis, referral, and disinfection, and decontamination of people as indicated. Number two is how to implement it of the large-scale social restriction, or we can call it PSBB. And then disinfection, decontamination, disinfection, disinfection, and the deratization of transport equipment and goods. And is to halt and to have safety and control of environmental media. Next, update of the pandemic COVID-19 in Indonesia on August 9th, 2020. This is the global situation today. Confirmed case is 19 million and the death is 716,000. Yeah, it's about. It's reported by WHO. Next, I think. Okay, in Indonesia, the number of the COVID-19 today confirmed that 125,000 increased 893 for today, and the number of the patient recovering, it's about 80,000, and dying 5,700. Indonesia is in a is in the 22nd position of all countries exposed to COVID-19. Next. Okay, this is the policy that taken to response the pandemic COVID-19 by the government, that the government the priorities is public health emergency with a large social restriction, and there is a presidential instruction to regional and the district heads to implement about the health protocols and also about the punishment, who not implemented the health control. Next. This is about the budgeting for handling COVID-19, that the government allocation, it's about 955 billion. Yeah, it's about it's equivalent with 46 billion dollar. Yeah, this budget is divided for health, for social protection, yeah, and then majorities is for subsidies for small businesses or corporation. Next. Yeah. For break up the transmission principle, it's three things. Yeah, I think it's implemented in all the global pandemics now, how to stay in place, yeah, and then how to maintain your space and how to cover your face, yeah, with anything you can face the nose, mouth from the spreading of the droplets. Next. Okay, health system preparedness by the government of Indonesia now is the hospital who's the handling the COVID-19, the number is 755. Yeah, it's including the government hospital and then the private hospital. The for the number of the bed is about 166,000. Indonesia is also started to implement about the telemedicines as the first guaranteed of the health services in era COVID-19. Yeah, health ministry in cooperation with some of the Indonesian Telemedicine Association. Yeah, there is Allo Dokter, Go Apotek, Dokter Sehat, and others. The telemedicine services consists of the providing health information and education, and then providing online consultation on health issues, and how to check and nursing services, and then home rapid test, drugs administration, directing directing referrals to health facilities of our to hospitals. Next. Okay, this is the situation about the health personnel and volunteers for handling COVID-19 existing in 2,877 hospital. There are 40,000 medical specialists 2 million others health workers in health facilities and 11,000 general practitioners. Total volunteers who have been placed, it's about 894 people. It's contained provisional organization. There is our government have program that Nusantara Sehat, yeah. Terdiri dari 91 orang, and then from Politeknik Kesehatan, from Health Minister, and then from Ministry of Education and Culture. And they are spread in all the facilities who are handling the COVID-19. Next. Okay, preventive and promotive effort in the emergencies response period for COVID-19. The first is information. Penyebarluasan lah informasi about the health and educate community about the COVID-19, yeah, with the digital platform or the mass iklan layanan masyarakat, ya, yeah, lalu juga how to membuat ke pedoman untuk health worker sendiri dan juga untuk masyarakat, and then the untuk kelompok juga yang rentan, including the fasilitas peribadahan, ya, termasuk juga fasilitas peribadahan hari ini melibatkan juga tokoh-tokoh agama, ya. Lalu tadi disinfection, and then pemasangan wash hand facilities, ya, in public area. And then pemberdayaan masyarakat to preventive of the COVID-19 sampai dengan ke tingkat RT, RW, dan juga di desa. Lalu juga ada untuk peningkatan ekonomi juga dilakukan juga adanya padat karya tunai desa. Next. Ya, yeah, ini collaboration with other countries. Ya, yeah, today our government have the collaboration with some countries to handling the COVID-19, ya. Yeah. And Indonesia as the leader in the ASEAN. Banyak hal dilakukan, ya, dari mulai update tentunya situasi COVID-19 di Indonesia sendiri, berbagi juga pengetahuan dan keahlian, ya, lalu juga tetap melakukan pemeriksaan epidemiologi dan juga melakukan dukungan teknis dan material dan financing, lalu berbagi informasi dan pengalaman teknis terkait dengan kesehatan, bagaimana panduan dan protokol kesehatan. Penguatan juga kepada fasilitas kesehatan, ya. Di ASEAN sendiri juga ada pembentukan ASEAN COVID-19 Response Fund, ASEAN Reserve Warehouse untuk kedaruratan, lalu juga SOP situasi darurat kesehatan masyarakat dan protokol penelusuran kontak dan investigasi, ya. Lalu ASEAN dengan United States juga dilakukan bagaimana support pengembangan struktural pengendalian penyakit menular. Next. ini it's about international collaboration di ASEAN with Singapore. Ada beberapa bantuan ya di alat kesehatan, termasuk juga vitamin ya dengan Filipina, juga sama Vietnam, Tiongkok, Jepang, Korea Selatan, dan juga Amerika Serikat. Next. Okay, I think that's all the update about the COVID-19 in Indonesia right now. Thank you for the
pesan. Thank you, Dr. Kuti, for your presentation about the updates of the situation of COVID-19 in Indonesia. Any questions will be allocated until after the second panelist speaks, so we will have a simultaneous question and answer session later. To summarize what the first speaker has said during her presentation, earlier she had talked about the prevention, control, and eradication strategies from Indonesia itself in handling COVID-19, and also about the health system preparedness from Indonesia, and also how telemedicine can play a big role in today's pandemic, especially because we have to be doing all the physical distancing. So telemedicine really does play a big role in how we can combat and how we can prevent COVID-19. And also, we were told about the update of the daily situation of COVID-19, which also talked about the collaboration with other countries and also collaboration with other international bodies, for example, with ASEAN and many other bodies. Some of the things that were shared with Indonesia were the sharing of knowledge and also epidemiology training, and also the strengthening of the health system and how we can share strategies between each country so that we can know what works and what doesn't work and how we can strengthen the health system in Indonesia so that we can keep on combating the COVID-19 outbreak. And that is it for the summary from the first panelist. Again, thank you very much, Dr. Kuti, for the presentation. Next, we would like to invite the second panelist, which is Dr. Ferry Rahman, as the Deputy Secretary General of PBID, or the Indonesian Doctor Association. He is also a part of the COVID-19 task force in Indonesia. So without further ado, Dr. Ferry, you may have the floor.
Okay, thank you. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin wa bihi nasta'inu ala umuri dunya waddin wassalatu wassalamu ala asrafil anbiya wal mursalin wa ala alihi washabi ajmain amma ba'du. Firstly, we would to say alhamdulillah to Allah because we get help for today on pandemic virus in our country. And the second, I would to say thank you for OECD Yacht for the invitation. Because it's the first time I present on this forum, and thank you for my mentor Mr. Tantan Taufik Lubis. He is my mentor when I'm on when I was at medical student until now, and thank you and to Dr. Putisari. I want to say for the success for the Congress yesterday, for the health Congress yesterday of Gerindra success. And on this forum, maybe I will present that I will present topic PowerPoint from my chairman of Indonesian Medical Association. I will share. Maybe the host can permit me to share the PowerPoint. Izin hostnya, saya diizinkan. Yeah. Untuk... Belum dapat izin. Host.
Sudah kami izinkan, Pak. Silakan.
Siap. Oke. Yeah, exactly. Mr. Lubis, I'm still a student until now. I'm now a student at University of Indonesia on doctoral program. So if I become a member of OIC Youth, it can be. Yeah. This slide is come from Mr. Deng M. Fakih. He is the chairman of PBED, Executive Board of Indonesian Doctor Association. Correctly that I'm not from at Gugus Tugas COVID on this country, but at PBED. Yeah, I'm now as Vice General Secretary. Okay. This is the policy of ED, Indonesian Doctor Association, on pandemic COVID-19. Firstly, we know that COVID-19 on March 2020, this association directly to get Satgas COVID-19. This Satgas is to get coordination with ED wilayah on province and ED cabang at district. We know today we have 200,000 doctor at Indonesia. We have 200,000 doctor in Indonesia. This Satgas, firstly, we get information. You know, on March 2020, we do not usually use Zoom like this, but we use like WhatsApp group. So to coordinate with our friends at province or city, we use WA group. This Satgas also make a protocol like education to people how they tell about the danger of COVID-19. We know today that there are some people is said that COVID-19 is not danger. Yeah, we get to a pedoman penanganan COVID-19 like protocol to our doctor. Firstly, APD, it's mean like masker or hazmat, like shoe cover, or the others, hand scoon like that. Yeah, and then we support to our government to get many PCR testing. We coordinate with MOH, Ministry of Health. And then we don't refer to use like rapid test, no. But PCR is the good choice to detect about COVID. It also depend on WHO. Okay. And we coordinate with five organization the others like Association of the Dentistry or and nurse and midwife and apotheker. We use we had like intensely meeting And then we also get opinion to our government to open data patient of COVID. You know, if we open data patient of COVID, yeah, we can detect whom the people get COVID, and we can contact tracing, and we can localize this case. We hope that this case is not large to the other area. And also, we coordination with Ministry of Health and also with Chairman of BNPB. You know, Mr. Doni is also Chairman of Gugus Tugas. And then we open donation from many people because APD is difficult to get to our doctors. And also when we get the APD, it's mean like mask, hazmat, yeah, we give the first for PPDS, it's mean doctor who studying to get specialist, because PPDS is the frontliner, is the first frontliner to cure a patient of COVID. And also we give to ED wilayah on province or ED cabang. We have 34 ED wilayah, 34 ED wilayah province, and we have 450 at district, at city or kabupaten. It's the first time. It's the first priority us. Yeah, and also we get make a protocol to our doctor, like SOP, standard of procedure use IPD, and also we have to clearly that IPD like what is the best, you know. When April, maybe there are many APD. I think it's false, not true, I think. And then we have introduction to our doctor to get telemedicine. Last Dr. Putisari have explained to us about telemedicine. Yeah, you know, until today we have 74 doctors have passed away because COVID-19. We don't know they get COVID-19 get from compression or from where, we don't know. So we have comment to our doctor to get telemedicine. We use technology, and also when we get a patient, we have to use APD, and we also get team audit about the death of our doctors. Yeah, we will know why this doctor is dead from patient or from else. And then we also tell to Ministry of Health to get like charity to our doctors. and we get team mitigation. We support to our government to get lockdown, but in our terminology we don't use lockdown, but PSBB. And we also to get to detection this case massively, like testing PCR massive and largely, and also isolation and treatment and contact tracing. You know, at RS Wisma Atlet, there are patients, but just only OTG. OTG, it means patient doesn't have a symptom. So patient with severity is it's not bad. Patient OTG, patient doesn't have a symptom. But if patient have a symptom like maybe like kasus-kasus yang berat, itu dibawa ke rumah sakit rujukan, Persahabatan, RSCM, Sulianti Saroso, yeah. And then we also comment to our doctors, all doctors, gerakan dokter semesta. It mean doctor movement, all doctor movement. All doctor movement, it mean all doctor, tidak terkecuali, bukan cuma dokter spesialis paru, tapi semua dokter di seluruh Indonesia, all doctors at Indonesia, yeah, have developed and have influenced three aspects. First, doctors have to know about therapy of COVID. First. So the second, to our doctors can check like PCR, can check like rapid. Yeah. And the third, doctor can use and way of the APD, because there is a report. Doctor can get COVID because when they use of the APD, they tertular. And also, we know that COVID, we don't know COVID when it can be finished. I think COVID can be finished when the vaccine is massive, tersebar sampai ke semuanya. Jadi kalau hari ini vaksin belum ada, maka COVID tidak akan sampai selesai. We should different about vaccine and therapy. Vaccine is not therapy. Therapy is not vaccine. Vaccine is just to prevent like meningitis, CR cervix, kanker cervix, or like flu, yeah, like typhoid. Is vaccine just to prevent, just only to prevent. But like herbal, like herbal is just only prevent. They are not therapy. If therapy like paracetamol, like antacid, that's a therapy. We support to Bio Farma to get a vaccine, and now uji coba ke 1,600 orang. We hope on January 2021 we get vaccine to our people. And also we support good testing for our people, and detection is yang ketat, ya. we get analysis to strategic about to mengatasi vaksin ini, apa COVID ini, and also on protokol kesehatan, you know that our president 3 days ago or 4 days ago, our president Mr. Jokowi issue the impress number 6/2020, yeah, that people if don't use masker or else or like physical distancing, so they get penalty. We hope our governor and our bupati also good make a regulation. Impress is okay. So turunannya ke pergub maupun peraturan bupati harus dibuat. Nah, you know, crisis at East Java because there are the case mostly the most I think at Indonesia, Jakarta number 2, but the East Java is number 1. Our doctor hampir 30 from Jawa Timur, yeah, is have passed away. So when we get APD, firstly distribute to East Java, and also we have at Sutomo Hospital because their doctor cannot operate, so they should support by the others area. I think it's enough for our presentation. Thank you. Thank you for today. Wallahul muwaffiq ila thoriq. Nasrul minallah wa fa'lun qarib. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Dr. Ferry, for your elaborate presentation about what EB or the Indonesian Association of Doctors does or has been doing to combat COVID-19 itself. To summarize what Dr. Ferry has said during his presentation, first, one of the first things that ED did was the formation of a COVID-19 task force to help handle the spread of COVID-19 in Indonesia. And then after that, about creating the protocols and also about PCR testing and all the PPE or the personal protective equipment, and also how PCR testing is preferred over the rapid tests because they come out more accurate. Also, she talked about the issue of the death of health workers and how vaccines are prevention, which cannot be used for therapy, and about how one of the latest impress or regulations from the president, Jokowi, about the penalty about not doing physical distancing or also wearing PPE in public. And that can also be derived as regulations per province. So thank you once again to Dr. Ferry for your presentation. Next, we will be moving on to the question and answer session. For participants that would like to ask questions, you may ask in the chat room. We already have some questions from some of the participants. I will be reading the first one. The first one is, how can countries collaborate for combating the pandemics? I think this can be answered by Dr. Puthisari first. How can countries collaborate for combating pandemics?
I think we can. We have to collaborating in all leading sectors, not only for the government or we in a legislative in a parliament. It have to to involve the organization of the health provision, and then to the mass community. I think we have to collaboration with all the all sectors to handling this pandemics.
Thank you, Dr. Puti. The same question for Dr. Ferry. How can countries collaborate for combating pandemics, especially because you are from UD, or the Association of Indonesian Doctors? Have you collaborated with doctor associations from other countries?
Yeah. We don't want a situation like Philippines. You know, at Philippines today, their doctor and nurse mengusulkan to President Duterte to lockdown because the case is meningkat pesat ya, terus dokter-dokternya juga banyak yang berguguran ya. We don't want like that. Firstly, maybe we can coordination collaboration with the other countries, and we have a message from Timur Tengah that they want support from us. They want support the doctor to help our Muslim at Eastern, at Timur Tengah, We have a message and we have surat ya dari sana sudah ada permintaan. Itu aja mungkin.
Okay, so what Dr. Ferry had stated before was that countries from the Middle East also have asked for Indonesia's collaboration.
Yes.
COVID-19.
Yeah. Sudah ada permintaan dari asosiasi dokter dari Timur Tengah kepada Indonesia untuk teman-teman dokter Indonesia untuk membantu membackup di sana. Ya sudah ada.
To interpret again, Dr. Ferry has stated that doctors from the Middle East have asked for help from doctors in Indonesia to help back them up during the COVID-19 situation. I also want to remind both panelists, to Dr. Puti Sari and also to Dr. Ferry, that if you would like to answer in Indonesian, I can also interpret the answer, so it might create ease when answering. So the next question is, is it possible to balance healthcare or economics? Should we sacrifice one for the sake of other? I think I will let Dr. Ferry answer this one first.
Sorry.
Is it possible to balance healthcare and economics, or should we sacrifice one for the sake of the other?
Yeah. I think kesehatan dan ekonomi ini kan saling menopang. Kalau ekonominya tapi kesehatannya masih lumpuh, maka ekonomi tidak akan bisa bangkit. Tentu pertama sekali tugas pemerintah adalah hari ini fokus kepada kesehatan dulu, baru nanti mungkin ekonomi. Apa seperti itu pertanyaannya?
Kenapa, dokter? The balancing healthcare economics.
Balancing economics kan antara ekonomi dan kesehatan kan, ya. Keduanya saling berkaitan. Kita tahu bahwa hari ini sudah ada pengumuman beberapa negara yang sudah mengalami resesi ekonomi dunia ya. Karena pandemi COVID ini. Oleh karenanya, Presiden hari ini fokus kepada kesehatan supaya COVID ini cepat berakhir, artinya dengan protokol yang sangat ketat, ya, supaya ekonomi pun tetap jalan, ya, maka tidak bisa kita membuka selebar-lebarnya, atau kalau di Amerika itu mungkin dikenal dengan herd immunity. Artinya herd immunity itu dibiarkan begitu saja yang meninggal, yang sakit, ya kan ekonomi tetap berjalan. Tapi faktanya di Amerika sudah tembus 100.000. Tapi presiden kita tidak demikian. Artinya kesehatan tetap priority, selain juga dengan ekonomi. Itu mungkin yang mudah-mudahan bisa menjawab. Mungkin Ibu Putih bisa membantu.
To interpret the answer first from Dr. Ferry, one of his answers was that seeing from the situation in the United States, how they are implementing herd immunity, but the reality is that the cases have still went over 100,000 cases, but their economy is still going on. We can see how this is happening in Indonesia, that we are still putting health, we're still putting health over economics. So thank you for your answer, Dr. Ferry. I would also like to ask the same question to Dr. Putih. Is it possible to balance healthcare and economics, or should we sacrifice one for the sake of other?
Sorry, can you? I can't hear that. Yeah.
Is it possible to balance healthcare and economics, or should we sacrifice one for the sake of other?
Yeah, of course. It should be work together between economic and health. Right. The national economic Indonesian now is depends on the community consumption. Yeah. So community consumption is dipengaruhi oleh ekonomi masyarakat itu sendiri. So ekonomi masyarakat can work if they have a good health, but in the pandemic situation, how to all the parties include the people, include the community, have to take discipline, yeah, to implementing health protocols in their work in the office.
Thank you, Dr. Putih, for the answer. So earlier, Dr. Putih had said that we need to balance between economics and also health, so that both are integrated into each other, and that how economics also helps health, and how health helps economics itself. Next, we have a question from Ms. Rahmanita. She said she wanted to ask the question straight to the panelists. To Ms. Rahmanita, you may have the floor. You may ask your question.
Yeah, thank you, moderator. So can I speak Bahasa?
Yes, you may.
Yes. Yeah, actually my name is Nabila. Sebenarnya nama aku Nabila, tapi tadi rupa ngelirim. Jadi izin bertanya, panitia, moderator, terima kasih. Terima kasih penjelasannya kepada Dr. Putih dan Dr. Ferry. Sebenarnya nggak banyak sih yang ingin ditanya, ada juga. Sebenarnya yang udah ingin saya tanya, tapi saya lihat di chat beberapa teman-teman sudah bertanya. Tapi begini dok, yang saya lihat di media sosial beberapa minggu belakangan, mungkin teman-teman yang in charge di media sosial juga tahu tentang YouTuber ataupun selebgram, artis, bahkan musisi yang membuat konten-konten konspirasi terkait COVID-19 ini. Mungkin mau minta pandangan Dr. Putih dan Dr. Ferry, boleh dimention nggak sih siapa namanya? Ya, kita tahu lah ya, musisi Anji dan Dr. Hadi, even sebenarnya udah diklarifikasi juga oleh Dr. Tita dan beberapa Kemenkes. Mungkin mau minta sudut pandang dari Dr. Putih dan Dr. Ferry. Terima kasih.
For this question, Dr. Putih may answer first.
Yeah. Tentang konten yang beberapa waktu belakangan ini cukup menghebohkan, ya memang di satu sisi banyak bermunculan, ya saya kira pihak-pihak yang mungkin awalnya ingin terdorong lah membuat inovasi-inovasi. Membantu dengan penemuan-penemuan apa obat-obat, bukan obat sih ya, tapi lebih kepada pengobatan penunjang mungkin ya, tadi seperti yang disinggung juga oleh dokter ini, apa obat-obat herbal dan lain sebagainya, itu banyak sekali yang hari ini diklaim membantu proses penyembuhan gitu. Memang dari sisi obatnya sendiri belum ada yang bisa terkonfirmasi ya, bisa benar-benar menyembuhkan. Tapi tentunya apa yang informasi diberikan ini yang memang hari ini perlu ada filter ya, filter untuk semua media, saya kira baik media sosial gitu, terkait dengan informasi kebenaran dari informasi yang disampaikan, termasuk juga pertanggungjawaban dari informasi tersebut gitu. Jadi memang hari ini dengan banyaknya pihak-pihak yang mungkin termotivasi tadi ingin turut serta andil di dalam penanganan COVID-19 ini ya, sehingga muncul tadi banyak sekali yang ya tanda kutip mengklaim lah ya, menemukan obat ataupun juga apa bentuknya gitu di dalam penanganan ini. Jadi memang perlu sangat hati-hati hari ini ya, di tengah pandemi ini banyak di luar juga ekspektasi, harapan ya dari banyak pihak terhadap segera berakhirnya pandemi ini dengan ditemukannya obat gitu kan terhadap virus COVID-19 ini gitu. Jadi memang ya dengan kemudahan teknologi dan lain sebagainya memang menjadi tantangan tersendiri ya penyebar luasan informasi tersebut, tapi saya kira harusnya memang pemerintah bisa segera meng-counter pemberitaan-pemberitaan yang memang belum bisa confirm betul ya atas kebenarannya. Itu saya kira.
Thank you, Dr. Puti, for the answer. Before we move on to the answer from Dr. Ferry, I'd like to interpret first. Earlier, Ms. Nabila asked, what are your perspectives about the celebrities that have made controversial statements about finding the cure for COVID-19? So the answer from Dr. Puti was that there are some people that are motivated to find herbal medicines, which are claimed to help cure COVID, but there also needs to be a filter on social media to verify the info so that not everyone consumes the information as it is, because as we know, there's a lot of information going on the internet and in all kinds of social medias where not everything is verified. So people also need to be very cautious in the info that we consume. So thank you for the answer to Dr. Puti. Next, we'd like to also ask Dr. Ferry about his perspective on this phenomenon.
Yeah. Baik, saya coba menjawab yang lagi heboh pemberitaan di media belakangan ini. Bedakan obat dengan vaksin. Ya, herbal, ada memang obat herbal ya, katakan temulawak dan lain-lain itu beda, ya kan? Obat ya artinya memang ada penyakit obatnya. Tapi kalau vaksin itu bukan obat. Vaksin itu lebih kepada pencegahan ya. Tadi saya sampaikan ada vaksin meningitis, vaksin tipes, vaksin flu, kalau mau umroh ya kan, vaksin kanker serviks pada perempuan ya. Banyak sekali vaksin ya. Vaksin BCG, vaksin hepatitis supaya tidak terjadi. Itu vaksin ya. Obatnya ada lagi obatnya ya kan. Obat TBC ada lagi ya kan, obatnya tidak lagi ya kan. Di video yang viral itu beliau menyampaikan ya, yang pertama adalah ini obat. Ada itu di ini obat pasien COVID ya kan. Habis itu 2 hari kemudian diklarifikasi ya kan, ini herbal ya kan, untuk apa antibody, padahal antibody itu namanya antibody ya di dalam tubuh, body ya kan, tubuh yang membentuk kekebalan ya kan, bukan dia langsung minum begitu, bukan ya, itu yang prinsip mungkin yang mesti kita pahami. Terus saya kira ya kalau persoalan herbal ya, apapun itu ya, tumbuh-tumbuhan ya, buah-buahan aja ya, jeruk aja bisa juga kalau mau diklaim itu obat COVID, sebagai pencegahan COVID bisa juga jeruk itu ya kan. Mungkin ingat nggak dulu awal-awal COVID jeruk juga habis, apalagi itu tomat juga habis ya kan, karena itu juga membentuk daya tahan tubuh dari dalam gitu supaya kita tetap sehat, supaya kita tetap bugar ya kan. Lalu kalau ditanya ini mengandung apa ya kan, dalam minumannya itu mengandung apa, disebutlah juga semua buah-buahan, di semua disebut markisa, semua buah-buahan banyak sekali ya kan. Saya kira itu beda ya dengan Bapak Menteri Pertanian. Bapak Menteri Pertanian kan eukaliptus ya, eukaliptus ada senyawanya dan PBID malah mendorong ya kan. Betul nggak senyawa eukaliptus ini ya kan malah PBID kan melakukan penandatanganan riset bersama dengan Bapak Menteri ya kan, mau meneliti bukan kalungnya bukan, tapi senyawa yang dikandung di eukaliptus itu ya kan. Lain halnya yang musisi yang tadi itu ya kan, obatnya apa ya, obatnya banyak ya, apa mengandung dari berbagai macam buah-buahan ya kan, sampai tidak ada juntrungannya apapun ya kan. Kalau eukaliptus ada jurnal ilmiahnya bahwa eukaliptus itu mengandung apa, ada senyawa yang terkandung juga ada, itu yang akan kita teliti ya kan. Jadi saya kira untuk para influencer ya kan, yang punya subscriber sampai 1 juta, 2 juta atau 10 juta ya kan, mungkin hari-hari ini mungkin fokus kepada ya kan bagaimana supaya masyarakat ini tetap mengindahkan protokol kesehatan ya, bukan malah mengajak lepas masker ya kan. Enggak usah percaya itu yang saya kira salah. Dunia manapun hari ini, dunia manapun, di seluruh dunia manapun juga obat belum ditemukan, satu. Yang kedua, seluruh dunia sekalipun ya kan masih tetap menggunakan protokol kesehatan, sama protokol kesehatan yang punya kita dengan di Itali, dengan di Spanyol sama ya kan, sama dengan di Filipina, di Amerika sama ya kan, pakai masker, cuci tangan, jaga jarak ya kan, physical distancing, prinsipnya itu saja ya kan, apa, menghindari kerumunan ya kan. Seluruh dunia juga mengatakan demikian ya kan, artinya ini sudah dikaji oleh seluruh pakar, profesor-profesor terbaik seluruh dunia, bahwa penanganan virus COVID hari ini ya, yaitu tetap dengan protokol kesehatan, pencegahan ya. Obat masih dicari, kita tahu obatnya waktu itu sempat pernah obat sampai presiden mengumumkan ya kan, hidrokloroquine, obat malaria ya kan, yang langsung habis seketika ya kan, padahal yang tahu kan dokter nih, pada kasus-kasus yang seperti apa, kasus yang berat, kasus yang ringan mungkin tidak perlu ya kan, ya kan. Jadi bagi kita pencegahannya apa, udah makan aja, makan yang sehat-sehat, nggak, bukan makan yang junk food, makan buah-buahan sebanyak-banyaknya ya kan. Saya sendiri juga makan jeruk juga tiap hari, itu juga saya katakan dia obat COVID juga, jeruk ya kan, juga obat COVID juga, lemon itu obat COVID juga. Artinya kepada influencer hari ini, bukan pada tempatnya ya kan, menghardik ya masyarakat, apalagi memberikan sebuah apa protokol yang di luar protokol kesehatan ya, ini sudah dikaji ya kan ya, apalagi janganlah influencer itu apa dipanggil profesor udah seneng ya kan, prof nggak taunya besok ya itu kan cuma panggilan kesayangan saya ya kan, dok itu kan panggilan kesayangan saya ya kan. Saya bukan seorang anggota ID loh, katanya pakar mikrobiologi. Mikrobiologi itu identik dengan apa? Kalau di dokter itu ada SPMK, jadi spesialis namanya di SPMK, yaitu spesialis mikrobiologi klinik. Jadi meneliti tentang virus semuanya itu ada itu, ya kan? Ya harusnya kan dibantah pada saat wawancara. Itu mungkin kepada influencer mungkin hari ini ya kita mendukung pemerintah lah, ya kan? Ini sudah kajian, ya kan? Coba lihat di Saudi Arabia, haji aja berjarak, nggak bisa deket-deketan ya, udah gitu cuma dibatasi cuma berapa seribu orang. Artinya ini sudah melakukan sebuah kajian yang matang. Itu mungkin.
Thank you, Dr. Ferry, for the answer. I would like to interpret for our international participants as well. From Dr. Ferry, his answer was that we should be differentiating between the herbs or medicines with vaccines, because as earlier stated in the presentation, is that vaccines are a form of prevention and not a form of medicine for COVID-19 itself. And in Indonesia, there were lots of information regarding how certain fruits and certain plants can help in curing COVID-19. For example, the COVID-19 necklace that was made out of eucalyptus that was introduced by the government not too long ago. So what Dr. Ferry had stated was that it's not the necklace itself that can cure, that can help prevent catching COVID-19, but it's what's inside the eucalyptus and how it can play chemical-wise. And also, Dr. Ferry stated that all protocols around the world are the same. For example, physical distancing, having to wear masks outside, and also just eating healthily. This is the prevention that we can do. This is the prevention that we can take as citizens so that we can help not only ourselves, but also help the government in how we can press down the number of COVID-19 cases, because as we know, no country has the medicine yet. A lot of countries are already doing trials. Also, Indonesia has started the trials for the vaccine. And earlier, Dr. Ferry had also stated that there are around 1,600 people that are ready to volunteer to try the vaccine. So going back to the issue of the influencers that was asked by Ms. Nabila earlier about what the perspective was about these influencers that go out and say things that are not true about COVID-19. For example, people saying that they have found the medicine or they have found the cure for COVID-19, is that the influencers should be able to trust the government more because of the studies that have already been done, because of all of the information and how the policies and all the regulations are being fact-based and based upon studies. And it's not just them putting it out there, but it's already been through a lot of steps and a lot of asking peers about what they think about this and how we can integrate the facts into to become regulations. So thank you to both panelists for the answers. Next, we would like to open the floor to another question. Earlier we had a participant named Miss Elena that would like to ask a question. You may have the floor.
Oke, terima kasih kepada moderator yang telah memberikan saya kesempatan untuk bertanya. Terima kasih juga kepada narasumber yang sudah menyampaikan materi yang bermanfaat. Saya Lena dari Tangerang. Untuk kedua narasumber, saya punya pertanyaan. Kira-kira prediksinya itu setelah vaksin keluar, berapa lama lagi hingga dikatakan COVID-19 di Indonesia itu sudah selesai? Terus yang kedua, akhir-akhir ini kan suka ada rumor yang keluar mengenai uji coba. Katanya uji coba itu orang Indonesia dikatakan kelinci percobaan untuk uji coba. Nah, sebenarnya ini tahap apa aja sih dilalui sampai bisa dikatakan kita sedang melalui tahap uji coba? Jadi itu apa aja yang mesti dilalui para ilmu saintis untuk mengeluarkan vaksin hingga sampai tahap uji coba? Terus berapa lama bisa dikatakan bahwa uji coba tersebut berhasil? Itu aja sih. Terima kasih.
Before we move on to the panelists' answer, I'd like to interpret the question first. Miss Elena asked about how long is it until the prediction when the vaccine is able to be distributed between the for the people, for example, like the people of Indonesia or people all around the world, and when is also the prediction of when COVID could end in Indonesia? And the next question is, we've heard about the vaccine trials and how there are a lot of rumors about Indonesian people being the lab hamsters, or like being the people that are tested for the vaccines. The participant wanted to know, what exactly are the steps that a vaccine has to go through? What are the steps of the trial from the beginning until the vaccine is able to be distributed? I will give the floor to Dr. Kutisari first to answer the questions by Ms. Elena. You may have the floor.
Yeah. Soal prediksi, memang sampai dengan hari ini tidak ada satupun yang berani memprediksi kapan COVID-19 ini selesai, gitu ya. Memang kalaupun adanya vaksin itu hanya untuk pencegahan. Tadi Dr. Ferry juga sampaikan bukan untuk mengobati, ya. Dan hari ini ya kita sebagai bagian daripada global community kita punya responsibility collaboration dengan beberapa negara, ya, untuk bersama-sama, ya, menemukan vaksin tersebut. Makanya hari ini salah satu BUMN kita yaitu Bio Farma punya kerjasama dengan Sinovac China, ya, untuk menemukan vaksin COVID-19 ini, dan hari ini sudah tahap ketiga clinical test, ya, tes uji klinis tahap ketiga yang tadi disampaikan melibatkan 1.600 relawan untuk mengetahui efektivitas dari vaksin tersebut, gitu. Jadi memang tes uji klinis tahap ketiga ini adalah dalam rangka menemukan efektivitas vaksin. Jadi memang kan sudah ada tahap pertama dan kedua terkait dengan keamanan vaksin, calon vaksin ini, ya. Dan hari ini yang dikerjasamakan dengan Bio Farma dan dilakukan pengetesan dengan 1.600 relawan itu adalah tahap ketiga untuk menguji keefektifan apakah ini punya benar-benar bisa melawan si virus COVID-19 itu atau tidak. Nah, untuk beberapa tahap saya tidak begitu paham, ya, berapa tahap lagi pengujian vaksin tersebut bisa benar-benar terkonfirmasi menjadi vaksin COVID-19 gitu. Tapi memang kita terus berupaya, saya kira, dengan kolaborasi dengan beberapa negara, ya. Kenapa dengan China? Karena memang dianggap sebagai sama-sama negara ASEAN, dan katanya juga terkait dengan apa itu, ya, virus apa, ya, apa itu namanya, strain virusnya, ya, kalau nggak salah itu sama, punya kesamaan, ya, dengan yang terjadi di China, gitu. Jadi seperti itu terkait dengan perkembangan vaksin. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Pitisari, for the answer. I will be interpreting her answer first. First, about the predictions, it was stated that no one is actually brave enough to state when the prediction of when the vaccines will come out and when they will be able to be distributed to everyone. And also that the predictions of when the COVID-19 pandemic is able to end is also not known yet because of how the trials will go and how they will find if it's effective in people or not. And second, what she had stated was, in the global community, we have the responsibility to collaborate to help create the vaccine for COVID-19 as a means for prevention. And it was also stated that we are currently in the third clinical stage of the clinical trials. So what they are doing in the third stage is that we are doing this to test the efficacy of the vaccine itself, see if it's efficient in the people that are being given the vaccine. And before this third step, it was the second step, which was to find out the safety of the vaccine. So it was stated that there are a lot of steps. There are a couple of steps that we have to go through first to find the vaccine and to be able to distribute it to the people so that it will be effective once it is distributed and also safe for the people so that we're not endangering anyone. And also one of the reasons why Indonesia is in collaboration with China in finding the vaccine is because the strain of the virus, of the COVID-19 virus, is similar to the strains that were found in China. So that is why the collaboration between the two countries will also help in finding vaccines. So that is the answer from Dr. Futisari. Thank you for your answer. Next, we will be asking Dr. Ferry Rahman for his answer. Can we have the floor?
Baik, terima kasih Mbak Nadia. Tadi saya sampaikan bahwa kita punya harapan besar, optimis COVID-19 ini akan berakhir jika vaksin ini sudah ditemukan. Terkait dengan persoalan vaksin, artinya ketika vaksin ini sudah ditemukan, nanti akan bisa dibagi secara luas kepada masyarakat, bisa digunakan agar masyarakat yang tidak terkena COVID mungkin lebih aman, ya. Saya katakan setelah vaksin ini ditemukan. Yang kedua, benar yang disampaikan oleh Dr. Putisari bahwa strain COVID di Indonesia berbeda mungkin dengan strain COVID di Brasil, strain COVID di Amerika, beda, berbeda, ya kan? Dia COVID-nya mungkin masuk ke Indonesia ini sudah menyatu dengan penyakit-penyakit degeneratif di Indonesia hari ini. Ya, penyakit-penyakit yang paling banyak di Indonesia. Ya, penyakit-penyakit di tropis lah. Ya, ya jadi saya kira strain-nya sudah berbeda. Banyak sekali strain COVID. Ya, banyak sekali. Saya pernah membaca jurnal itu strain-nya sangat banyak. Ya. Kenapa diuji coba di Indonesia? Ya, kenapa diuji coba di Indonesia? Ya. Jadi saya tidak setuju pernyataan bahwa pada akhirnya Indonesia dijadikan sebagai kelinci percobaan. Bukan seperti itu melihatnya. Bahwa ya kan ketika diuji coba di Indonesia ada dua hal yang kita dapat. Ya. Yang pertama ya kan vaksin ini sudah cocok dengan kebanyakan penduduk Indonesia, sudah sesuai, ya kan? Katakan ya kan pada masyarakat ternyata dari seluruh katakan 1.600 ya kan kalau disuntikan vaksin ini ya kan lalu apakah dia menimbulkan reaksi seperti apa ya kan ada namanya reaksi pasca imunisasi itu reaksi pasca vaksin itu biasanya itu ada itu ya kan nah sehingga hal-hal ini bisa diminimalisir ya kan. Jadi vaksin ini nanti akan sesuai dengan penduduk di Indonesia. Ada vaksin-vaksin yang cuma ada di Indonesia, tidak ada di negara luar. Ada, ya. Seperti kayak contohnya mungkin kayak mungkin penyakit-penyakit yang ada di Indonesia tapi tidak ada di negara luar, ya kan? Contohnya nggak usah jauh-jauh dari Indonesia dengan Singapura lah, ya kan? Di Indonesia kita paling banyak pasien dengan DHF. Ya kan demam berdarah di Singapura nggak ada demam berdarah itu jadi orang-orang Singapura itu mungkin tidak tahu cara menangani penyakit demam berdarah itu tidak tahu ya karena memang penyakitnya unik sekali memang adanya cuma di Indonesia ya kan di tempat lain mungkin tidak ada ya kan kayak dulu di Afrika ada penyakit Ebola ya kan di Indonesia nggak ada tuh vaksinnya beda sekali ya kan bentuknya beda jadi yang tahu persis penyakit itu ya di sini nih ya kan jadi otomatis sumber penyakit ada di sini, obatnya pun ada di sini, ya. Nah, kenapa yang kedua? Keuntungan lagi yang kedua, ya kan? Karena diuji coba di Indonesia, ya kan? Maka Indonesia punya hak memproduksi sendiri dalam hal ini Bio Farma. Kalau kita menolak, saya tidak mau. Ya kan? Indonesia menolak, tidak mau, ya kan? Akhirnya Indonesia wajib beli, wajib membeli. Jadi Indonesia ini memiliki sebagian hak paten vaksin itu di Indonesia. Itu adalah milik Indonesia. Kalau tidak, kita wajib beli. Wajib beli ke negara luar. Kita nggak punya hak paten apapun. Dan kita akan bergantung ke sana terus. Bio Farma, BUMN kita tidak bisa memproduksi. Karena kita beli terus. Ada nggak vaksin yang demikian? Ada. Ada. Contoh, vaksin kayak, setahu saya, vaksin kayak kanker serviks tuh, ya kan? Itu diproduksi di negara luar. Indonesia belum bisa buat. Kemampuan Indonesia paling cuma bisa buat vaksin hepatitis, vaksin TB, ya kan? Nah, kalau enggak kita beli. Mungkin yang perempuan mungkin tahu enggak berapa harga vaksin kayak untuk kanker serviks? Sangat mahal sekali. Karena negara kita tidak bisa memproduksi. Nah, bayangkan kalau semisalnya vaksin itu diproduksi di dalam negeri sendiri, rumah kita sendiri, ya kan? Maka mungkin murah meriah. Maka mungkin katakan cuma berapa ratus ribu, ya kan? Sehingga ini nggak kayak seperti vaksin kanker serviks yang jutaan, karena hak patennya di negara luar. Jadi bukan jangan melihat dari kacamata kita jadi kelinci percobaan, tidak. Ini sudah dikaji. Kalau semisalnya ada efek samping seperti ini, maka langsung seperti ini, maka seperti ini, ya kan? Dan saya kira setelah vaksin ini berjalan, katakan sudah distribusi ke seluruh penduduk di Indonesia, ya kan, bisa dipakai, ya kan, dengan harga terjangkau karena BUMN kita yang memproduksi. Saya kira nanti akan terus dilakukan selama proses ini berjalan, ya kan. Obat ini kan biasanya kan pada tahap pada tahap yang sudah sangat matang sekali itu, mungkin kalau sudah 10 tahun, jadi penggunaannya mungkin 5 atau 10 tahun. Jadi kalau masih setahun nih, masih di nggak tahunya, semisalnya pada pasien dengan anak ternyata nggak cocok nih, harus sekian, ya kan? Kepada pasien anak atau pasien dengan punya penyakit darah tinggi, dia nggak bisa. Kita tahu bersama ya, pasien COVID hari ini di Indonesia hari ini ya, 51% penyakit penyertanya adalah darah tinggi. Penyakit penyertanya. Tentu di bayangan kita kalau 51%, ini data, 51% pasien COVID hari ini adalah punya penyakit penyerta darah tinggi. Nah ini kan dalam bayangan orang awam, kenapa darah tinggi? Karena suka makan yang asin-asin, garam bergaram, ya bisa jadi itu ya kan. Dan ini akan dilakukan kajian lagi nih. Mudah-mudahan pakar-pakar terbaik di negeri ini ya kan, UI, Unpad, UGM, Unhas, semuanya mengkaji, melakukan sebuah penelitian riset terus-menerus, sehingga nanti mungkin selama 5-10 tahun mungkin sudah ini. Tapi saya berharap secepatnya vaksin ini segera ditemukan supaya penyakit ini sudah selesai, anak-anak bisa sekolah. Itu saja. Karena anak-anak sudah gitu sekolah. Terima kasih.
Thank you, Dr. Ferry, for the answer. First, I would like to interpret the answer that was given. First, Dr. Ferry had stated that COVID-19 is predicted to end whenever the vaccine is found. And the predictions of when the vaccine is found is still unknown. We know that we already are going through the trials, but it's not known like when exactly it's going to come out. So there are no promises of when it's going to come out, but hopefully it will be soon. And after the vaccine is found, it will also be distributed to the public so that we can create safer living conditions in Indonesia. And it was also stated that the COVID strain in Indonesia is different from strains from all over the world. For example, the COVID strain in Indonesia would be different from the ones found in Brazil or even the US. And the strain itself that is found in Indonesia, it could be integrated with other tropical and degenerative diseases that are found in Indonesia. And what has been found is that there are many similarities with the COVID strains found in China, which is why one of the reasons why we are collaborating with China is because of the similarities itself. And the speaker also stated that please do not think that the Indonesian people are going to be lab rats for the vaccine, because this is not at all what is going to happen. So a breakdown of the trials that are going on in Indonesia, there are two reasons why it's beneficial for Indonesia to hold our own trials. The first one is because it will be used to find out whether or not it's suitable for Indonesians. We can see the reactions from the vaccines, like kind of reactions after being vaccinated, what will happen, and if anything happens, then these have already been studied as well, so they will know what kind of treatments they have to do afterwards. So that is one of the benefits, to find out whether or not this vaccine is suitable for Indonesians, because again, diseases from all over the world also require different kinds of vaccines, so it's not always going to be taking the same vaccine from, for example, from the US. We can't just bring the vaccine over here and want it to have the same effects, because that's not always going to be the case. And the second benefit is that if we hold the trials in Indonesia, then Indonesia also has the right to produce the vaccine themselves. We also have a part of the patent to produce the vaccine, because if we don't do that, that means that Indonesia has to buy the vaccine, and it will be more expensive for the Indonesian people to buy. For example, Dr. Ferry also stated that the vaccine for cervical cancer costs a lot here in Indonesia, because we don't have the patent to produce it. We don't have the means to produce this vaccine. Therefore, we have to buy it. And if this is also what happens for the COVID-19 vaccine, then it will take a lot longer, and it will take a lot more resources for us to gather what we need to help get the Indonesian people vaccinated against COVID-19. It was also stated that 51% of Indonesian COVID patients have hypertension. And this also plays a role in the different kinds of strains and how the different reactions of people from all over the world. We know that Indonesian people are prone to hypertension because of the kind of food that we consume. So, you know, the diet patterns, even the environmental situations, this also plays a role in the kind of vaccinations and the kind of help that we can get. And at this time, a lot of the universities in Indonesia are also doing their research so that we can know what kind of cures we can find, how, and also about the trials of the vaccine. So thank you, Dr. Ferry, for your elaborate response. Next, we'll be moving on to another question. There is a question.
Moderator, boleh nanya sedikit lagi menanggapi Dr. Ferry tadi sedikit, boleh nggak?
Oh, boleh.
Tadi, izin dok, tadi kan dokter juga menyinggung mengenai sekolah ya. Kebetulan saya ini, saya juga guru di SMA Negeri 70 Jakarta. Jadi, beberapa bulan yang lalu ada Google Form semacam seperti angket untuk para guru dan siswa. Mungkin Dr. Ferry dan Putih juga mempunyai anak yang sekolah juga di kawasan DKI Jakarta. Jadi, angket itu adalah untuk mengisi kesiapan kita terkait apakah kita siap untuk mengakhiri PJJ, pembelajaran jarak jauh ataupun BDR, dan mengenai kondisi fisik kita dan lain-lain. Jadi yang ingin saya tanyakan adalah dari perspektif medis sendiri, sebenarnya kan memang ada isu-isu bahwasannya sekolah ini kalau di zona hijau mungkin sudah ada beberapa sekolah yang buka, tapi di Jakarta Selatan sendiri khususnya di wilayah kita gitu kan dok, masih belum memungkinkan gitu kan. Nah, apalagi adanya klaster di perkantoran. Nah, untuk di sekolah sendiri sebenarnya perspektif dari para medis ini bagaimana dok terkait akan dibukanya sekolah kembali, baik itu dalam bentuk gelombang siang atau pagi, atau bagaimana, mungkin bisa dijawab singkat sedikit. Makasih moderator.
Thank you to Ms. Nabila, who has asked another question regarding the opening of schools and how ready Indonesian schools are being able to open. So before we go on to the answer, I would like to interpret the question. So because she is also a teacher at one of the schools in Jakarta, there was a questionnaire that was spread through to the students and also the parents of the students about the readiness to end online learning. And what the question is, what is the medical perspective that our panelists can give about how ready are schools to be open, and what exactly needs to be considered before opening the schools? I think I will give the question to Dr. Ferry first.
Yeah. Pembelajaran jarak jauh sebenarnya hampir mirip juga dengan telemedicine. Dokter pasien berkonsultasi secara online dengan dokter. Hampir sama lah sebenarnya. Ya. Melalui sebuah media teknologi. Dari segi kualitas pembelajaran jarak jauh maupun telemedicine masih kalah dibandingkan dengan tatap muka secara langsung. Ya. Hubungan pasien dengan dokter bagusnya itu tatap muka, jadi interaksi apa ya istilahnya intimisasi ya pertemuan, begitupun juga murid dengan seorang guru, artinya seorang guru juga sudah rindu sekali dengan anak-anaknya ya kan, dengan anak didiknya ya. Terkait dengan pembelajaran jarak jauh ini sebenarnya sudah cukup diulas secara matang ya di harian Kompas kalau nggak salah di hari Jumat itu di halaman depan Jumat apa Jumat apa Sabtu itu ya, kan diulas tuh secara matang ya kan. Ketika pembelajaran jarak jauh ini tidak memperhitungkan tidak memperhitungkan mitigasi dan segala resiko, maka ini bisa menjadi sebuah klaster baru. Kita tahu di Jakarta hari ini klaster perkantoran menjadi sebuah perhatian khusus. Apakah COVID tidak ada pada anak? Jangan salah juga, ada juga. Jangan salah juga ya. Tentu kita tidak berharap ya kan. Katakan mungkin anaknya mungkin karier malah dia membawa COVID pulang ke rumah. Itu yang tidak kita harapkan. Pembelajaran jarak jauh dalam hal ini pada terutama di zona-zona yang merah seperti Jakarta ya kan. Ada 8 provinsi negara ini memberi sebuah perhatian sangat serius ya terhadap Jakarta, Jatim, Jateng, Jabar, Sumatera Utara, terus Kalimantan Selatan, Sulawesi Selatan dan Papua. 8 provinsi dianggap masih zona merah. Dan di Jawa Barat sendiri yang masih paling merah itu adalah malah di Depok karena bersinggungan dengan Jakarta, ya. Artinya saya kira pemerintah tidak akan terburu-buru dan kami dari Ikatan Dokter Indonesia tidak merekomendit ya selama ini masih belum cukup aman ya. Saya tidak tahu apakah strateginya itu apakah semisalnya katakan satu kelas isinya 20, 10 masuk pagi, 10 masuk siang ya. Tentu tenaga pengajarnya juga mesti ekstra keras. Tenaga pengajarnya pun juga nggak boleh kelelahan juga, ya kan? Bicara COVID hari ini kita tidak boleh terlalu capai karena dokter aja dibatasi jam prakteknya hari ini, ya. Yang tadinya bisa praktek 12 jam hari ini cuma 5 jam kan karena harus banyak istirahat ya. Begitupun juga seorang dokter, begitupun juga seorang guru ya, nggak boleh juga terlalu monoton, terlalu banyak, ya kan? Aktivitas ya. Dan saya kira pekerjaan juga mungkin itu. Jadi untuk saat ini, terutama di zona-zona merah seperti yang saya sampaikan di 8 provinsi itu, kami IDI mungkin tidak merekomendasikan ya pembelajaran tatap muka secara langsung, namun tetap dengan pembelajaran jarak jauh. Memang saya sedih, saya sebagai orang tua juga sedih anak belajar secara online kualitasnya jauh berbeda dengan pada saat dia tatap muka langsung pasti berbeda ya kan, pasti berbeda karena guru tidak bisa mengkontrol secara langsung ya kan, tidak bisa melihat secara langsung perkembangan sang anak ya kan ya. Tapi daripada ini kesehatan kita tergadaikan, lebih baik hal ini mungkin lebih baik. Itu saja mungkin. Terima kasih Mbak Nadia Dolai.
Thank you Dr. Ferry for the answer. First I will be interpreting the answer. So what the panelists had stated was that online learning is very similar to telemedicine because you are doing both through a through an online media, for example, like through Zoom calls or through other kinds of platforms. But the quality is still not as intimate as you would if it were face-to-face. So you can see like a gap in the quality between going to school and having interactions with teachers and also other students compared to going to school online. But the issue here is that we can see that there are many clusters from work offices, and this is something that can happen if offline learning, normal learning would be implemented again. We can also find clusters in schools, and this is something that we do not want to happen. Because children, we cannot forget that children are still susceptible to COVID-19, and they could be carriers. They could be the ones that bring the virus home. They could be the ones that infect the people at home. So this is something that we do want to avoid, especially in red zones and red areas. And right now we know that Jakarta is one of the red areas. So this is something that we do want to avoid. And even by implementing strategies, for example, by doing shifts, having a morning shift and an afternoon shift, this is something that will make the teachers that teach too tired afterwards. And we want to avoid people getting too tired because that kind of state of being tired, that is something that also contributes to being susceptible to COVID-19 itself. Even doctors from working 12 hours per day have been limited to only working 5 hours per day because rest is very important for everyone in this situation. So from ED, from the Indonesian Doctor Association, it is not yet recommended to start doing offline school again. So thank you for your answer, Dr. Ferry. We would like to also ask for Dr. Putisari's answer about this question. You may have the floor.
Yeah, pada dasarnya sama seperti apa yang disampaikan oleh Dr. Ferry. Untuk wilayah-wilayah yang memang masih zona merah, prinsipnya kan tadi di dalam memutus mata rantai apa penyebaran COVID-19 ini kan ya memang kedisiplinan ya, kedisiplinan dalam menjaga jarak, kedisiplinan di dalam penggunaan masker, kedisiplinan juga di dalam ya membatasi kegiatan di luar rumah ya, termasuk bagaimana tentunya mempengaruhi apa kegiatan yang mempengaruhi terhadap imunitas. Nah, untuk anak-anak usia sekolah ini kan kelompok yang termasuk rentan ya, untuk bisa dikatakan tingkat kedisiplinan mereka melakukan protokol kesehatan. Bagaimanapun mungkin penerapan sistem pendidikan di sekolah yang akan diatur dengan penambahan jumlah jam ada pergantian shift dan lain sebagainya gitu ya. Apakah juga itu akan juga berjalan dengan efektif ya, apalagi tadi dikhawatirkan bagaimana dengan tenaga pengajarnya, jangan sampai juga itu justru menurunkan daya tahan tubuh dari para tenaga pengajar yang juga nantinya akan mempengaruhi juga kepada tentunya kualitas pembelajaran kepada mahasiswa kepada siswa-siswinya. Itu jadi memang prinsipnya adalah untuk saat ini ya mau tidak mau memang dilema antara kualitas dengan mengedepankan protokol kesehatan ya. Jadi tentunya tadi sudah disampaikan tidak direkomendasikan dari sisi medis ya, dari sisi kesehatan ya, sehingga memang ya harus bersabar saya kira untuk semua baik orang tua maupun juga siswa-siswi ya, untuk mau tidak mau ya penerapan pembelajaran jarak jauh ini terus dilakukan ya sampai kita mendapatkan ya kepastian atau mungkin juga kan karena hari ini juga masih terus meningkat walaupun landai masih terus meningkat jumlah kasus COVID-19 ini, sehingga ya tentu harapannya kalau memang nanti kondisinya situasinya sudah cukup terkendali gitu ya, mungkin akan ada kebijakan lain terkait dengan sistem pendidikan ini. Itu saya kira.
Thank you, Dr. Putisari, for the answer. I would also like to interpret her answer that a lot of how we can control the situation itself is by being disciplined and wearing masks and also being disciplined in physical distancing. And this is something that we cannot expect children to always do or to always pay attention to, because children are very susceptible towards not only COVID-19, but also many other kinds of infectious diseases. And by not upholding the protocols that we need, then they are at a much higher level of susception. So this is something that would not be recommended to start school again, because this would put the children in danger. And also the panelists talked about how shifts, the worry of shifts not being effective enough in teaching the kids, because we have to also consider the immunity of the teachers. You have to consider how tired they are if they are being put into shifts, and how that can also make them more susceptible and could even end up being carriers for the children. This can cause a very big fiasco if like a lot of the clusters could be found from schools. So for right now, patience is still the key. We still have to be patient in implementing online learning, even though it's not as effective, it's not as intimate, this is still something that we should still be considering to implement for the next semester because of all the concerns that were previously stated. Because all the number of cases of COVID-19 are still increasing, and only once the situation is controlled, then we can start considering putting our kids back to school. So thank you for your elaborate answer for Dr. Puthisari. We will be accepting only one more question, seeing that it is almost 10 o'clock. We have a participant named Mr. Diaz that wanted to ask a question. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Moderator, is my voice clear?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, thank you. Terima kasih kepada Bapak Ferry, Dr. Ferry, dan Ibu Dr. Puthisari. Sebenarnya yang ingin saya tanyakan itu, sekarang kan udah mulai banyak rumor-rumor mengenai bahwa adanya second wave-nya gelombang keduanya COVID, di mana dirumorkan itu lebih deadly, more lethal. Contohnya kayak di Wuhan dulu yang sempat bulan April aman, tiba-tiba bulan-bulan berikutnya muncul lagi gitu, dan bahkan lebih deadly than before. Terus ada lagi yang rumor dari WHO sendiri beberapa minggu kemarin, expert pada bilang kalau COVID tersebut sudah mulai bisa airborne lewat udara, padahal yang sebelumnya itu belum airborne. Ini menunjukkan kalau virus ini semakin lama semakin bermutasi, semakin lethal, dan banyak yang khawatir ya, walaupun ada vaksin yang sedang berjalan ini, it's not working gitu terhadap COVID ini. Bagaimana Bapak, Ibu sekalian? Gitu sih, terima kasih.
Thank you for the question. I would like to interpret the question first. It was asking about the rumors about the second wave of COVID-19 and how there are a lot more mortalities during the second wave and how it can be more deadly to the people, and also concerns that COVID-19 is becoming airborne. So the participant asked, what are the panelists' perspective about the second wave of COVID-19 that may happen in Indonesia? I would like to give the question to Dr. Puthisari first. You may have the floor.
Yeah. Terima kasih. Jadi memang rumor terkait dengan yaitu kan second wave, memang mungkin ada beberapa yang terjadi hal tersebut. Tapi kita sebenarnya masih di first wave karena memang belum ada penurunan jumlah kasus dari awal masuknya COVID-19 di Indonesia di bulan Maret sampai dengan hari ini. Gitu. Jadi kalau situasi hari ini kita masih di first wave, jadi tentu sebaiknya fokusnya kepada ya bagaimana menjaga protokol kesehatan itu secara ketat dilakukan ya di seluruh baik pemerintah juga maupun juga masyarakat itu sendiri gitu ya, dan juga tentu pemerintah paralel juga melakukan upaya-upaya yang lain untuk bisa menjaga ketahanan nasional juga ya, dari sisi tadi ekonomi nasional dan lain sebagainya gitu. Jadi memang itu saya kira fokusnya hari ini ya, karena kita masih di belum ada penurunan yang berarti, dan kita harapkan tidak ada second wave yang masuk ke Indonesia. Kalaupun nanti terjadi penurunan, ya sudah turun terus gitu ya, sehingga jangan sampai ada second wave masuk ke Indonesia dengan tadi rumor-rumor yang yang justru memang mengkhawatirkan, tapi jangan sampai kita justru memikirkan kekhawatiran yang belum tentu itu terjadi juga di Indonesia. Itu saya kira.
Thank you, Dr. Puthisari, for the answer. First, I would like to interpret the answer. Talking about the second wave, Indonesia itself is still in the first wave because from March until today, until August, there have not been any significant decreases in the number of cases of COVID-19 in Indonesia. So if we want to put it in a graph perspective, we are still at the point where we are still rising. Our number of cases are still rising, not even like going down yet. So we're still far away. Not hopefully we can continue to work on getting the number of cases decreased, but we are still it's talking about the second wave for now. Is it really relevant for us today, because our focus is still on how to implement the protocol to uphold the health in other sectors, for example, the economic sector, how we can still implement these protocols, but how we can also keep the wheels, the other gears going. So hopefully we will also not have to go through the second wave, but for right now, our main focus is not on the second wave, but how we can continue on decreasing the number of cases so we can get over the first wave. Thank you, Dr. Pisari, for your answer. We would like to ask for Dr. Ferry Rahman's answer. You may have the floor.
Yeah. Mengenai second wave, atau gelombang kedua yang menjadi sebuah rumor, saya tidak melihat bahwa hari ini kita ini sudah di second wave atau akan, ya belum ya kan. Tadi saya membaca di mana tuh, di Kompas atau di mana itu, bahwa pakar epidemiolog ini gelombang pertamanya masih belum selesai gitu. Masih belum selesai. Kita juga masih belum bisa melihat indikator second wave itu seperti apa, atau katakan gelombang satu itu selesai itu seperti apa, bahwa sudah tidak ada peningkatan kasus misalnya. Tapi fakta hari ini kan fakta terus masih angka positif kan masih di atas 1000. Pernah beberapa hari yang lalu sampai 2000. Pas Idul Adha itu pas Idul Adha itu 2000. Terus turun 1.500. Hari ini masih, kalau nggak salah, 1.800 angka positif. Tapi kenaikan positif ini bisa disebabkan karena beberapa hal. Misalnya, pemeriksaan yang secara masif hampir di semua tempat hari ini sudah cukup banyak. Ya. Kalau dulu mungkin cuma di rumah sakit, tapi hari ini sudah bisa di center-center, di tempat-tempat tertentu. Oleh karenanya, langsung dikatakan positif, ya. Sehingga dalam asumsi saya, angka kesembuhan juga terus meningkat, kesembuhan terus meningkat. Namun ini juga dibarengi dengan ini. Jadi saya melihat second wave ini belum, ya kan? Saya kira kita tidak perlu pesimis terhadap second wave, ya kan? Karena saya yakin seluruh stakeholder di Republik ini bekerja keras lah, artinya semua teman-teman dokter hari ini sedang mencari tahu nih supaya tidak terjadi gelombang kedua. Dan kami di Ikatan Dokter Indonesia ini baru-baru ini mungkin sudah akan menemukan sebuah formula pada pasien-pasien dengan pada saat penanganan COVID, artinya supaya dia tidak meninggal, karena sudah ada penelitian nih bahwa pasien COVID yang meninggal hari ini karena adanya sebuah gumpalan, artinya gumpalan darah dia menghambat jalan di jantung maupun di paru-paru, ya, sehingga dia tidak bisa, aliran darah terhambat. Sehingga kami sudah ada beberapa peneliti di Ikatan Indonesia ini, supaya bagaimana kalau pasien-pasien COVID ini diberikan, katakan, obat antikoagulan. Nah, ini sudah dipikirkan ke situ. Mudah-mudahan, karena sudah ada, kami melakukan riset, satu rumah sakit ketika menggunakan terapi ini, saya katakan, ini bukan vaksin, obat loh, obat pada pasien COVID yang memang dikatakan positif, terbaring, dipasang infus, lalu kita terapi dengan ini, hampir satu bulan ini, si rumah sakit ini sudah tidak ada kasus yang meninggal. Oleh karenanya, ini kita mau publish, kita undang seluruh pakar-pakar semua, ya kan? Mudah-mudahan ini lahir dari Indonesia, bahwa nanti Indonesia mungkin yang pertama kali nanti, supaya angka kematian ini menurun sekali. Saya kira kalau dari sisi angka kematian, kita mungkin agak minim hari ini dibandingkan periode-periode sebelumnya. Mudah-mudahan obat COVID ini cepat ditemukan. Demikian, Mbak Nadia.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Ferry Rahman, for your answer. I would like to interpret his answer first. So first of all, there have not been any facts that we have already entered the second wave. Because listening to epidemiologists, we know that the first wave is not yet over because there are no indicators of the first wave ending or the second wave even starting. So talking about the second wave, there's still no evidence of us starting it because cases until today are still increasing over thousands. For example, Dr. Ferry also stated that there was even a point where there were 2,000 cases found in one day. So the number of cases that are increasing per day, like this is still contributing to our first wave. But something positive that he wanted to bring up was that the number, even though the number of positive cases are increasing more than what we found during the beginning of the pandemic, our cure rate is also increasing, meaning that there are more and more people getting cured from COVID-19. So we don't need to be pessimistic because the experts are also working on how we can combat COVID-19 and how we can use the information that we have to find the correct cures. And also something interesting that was being studied over at IDI, or the Indonesian Association of Doctors, is that they were looking for a kind of pattern or a kind of formula between the patients, the COVID patients in Indonesia. And it was found that for several COVID patients in Indonesia, there was a blood clot blocking the blood flow from the heart. So what they did, what the doctors did, was give the patients anticoagulants that would help thin out the blood so that the blood flow can flow better. And this was found to be effective, thankfully, and this also helped contribute in the decreasing of the number of deaths found in COVID-19. So they said that they also wanted to publish this finding, and hopefully like this is something that can be contributed towards how we can decrease the number of COVID cases in Indonesia, because this is a breakthrough. This is not just a prevention, but it's also a treatment to COVID-19 patients. So hopefully this can also contribute to the decreasing of the number of cases that we found in Indonesia. So thank you to Dr. Ferry Rahman for your answer. And seeing that it is already 10:07, the last question was the last question in this webinar. So after this, we would like to ask for a closing statement from each panelist to just wrap up this session, so that after this, I would like to ask for a closing statement from Dr. Puthi Sarek first. You may have the floor.
Yeah, terima kasih atas kesempatannya. Jadi prinsipnya pada hari ini memang tadi saya sampaikan kedisiplinan dari semua pihak, ya, keikutsertaan dan kesadaran, ya, saya kira dari semua pihak di dalam menghadapi kondisi pandemi hari ini, memang ini yang sangat penting, sehingga memang bagaimana penerapan protokol kesehatan di semua sektor, ya, saya kira hari ini itu yang harus menjadi fokus bersama, ya, sehingga dari sisi kesehatan, ya, kita bisa memutus, paling tidak mengurangi penyebaran transmisi dari COVID-19 ini, dan dari sisi yang lainnya, ya, ketahanan nasional, termasuk juga bagaimana kondisi ekonomi bangsa ini juga tetap harus berjalan berdampingan, gitu ya. Jadi masyarakat di dalam menjalankan aktivitasnya, walaupun mungkin belum normal betul, ya, benar-benar normal, artinya ya, new normal ini keadaan kondisi yang memang mau tidak mau kita berdampingan dengan COVID-19 ini, ya, sehingga dengan memperhatikan protokol kesehatan, harapannya ini bisa mengurangi transmisi dari COVID-19. Itu saya kira.
Thank you, Dr. Puthi Sarek, for your closing statement. To interpret, she believes that the key to ending the pandemic and the key to making a better situation for us to live in is discipline from all sectors, from the public, from health sectors, from economic sectors. Everyone has to be disciplined in implementing the protocol so that we can face the pandemic in a better manner, and also so we can decrease the COVID transmissions. So thank you, Dr. Puthi Sarek, again for your closing statement. Next, I would like to ask Dr. Ferry Rahman for his closing statement. You may have the floor.
Ya, terima kasih Mbak Nadia. Closing statement saya adalah benar yang disampaikan adalah Dr. Putrisari, disiplin itu adalah vaksin kita yang sebenarnya hari ini. Kalau bicara kita vaksin lagi kita adalah disiplin. Artinya kita harus tetap mengindahkan protokol kesehatan, itu paling penting. Terus yang kedua, tugas bagi kita sebagai seorang influencer atau semisalnya selebgram maupun dan lain-lain adalah kita harus memberikan jiwa-jiwa optimis, artinya memberikan sebuah optimisme semangat kepada masyarakat, kepada sejawat, ya, bukan malah katakan mencaci maki, bullying atau semisalnya putus asa dan lain-lain. Mungkin Bapak Ibu mungkin ingat ya, mens sano in corpore sano, ya, bahwa dalam tubuh yang sehat terdapat jiwa yang sehat. Artinya kalau jiwanya sudah negatif terus, saya kira mungkin dia pasti punya penyakitan. Tapi kalau semisalnya optimis, berpandangan optimis, ya, mengedepankan persaudaraan, kebersamaan, saya kira mungkin kita akan terus sehat. Itu mungkin dua hal yang ingin saya sampaikan. Disiplin adalah vaksin kita yang sebenarnya saat ini. Yang kedua, teruslah kita optimis, ya, teruslah kita mengingatkan kepada saudara kita dulu, mulai dari keluarga kita, baru ke teman-teman kita. Artinya selalu mengingatkan. Terima kasih mungkin, itu saja.
Thank you Dr. Khairul Rahman for your closing statement to interpret. The panelists stated that discipline is our greatest vaccine today. This is how our own discipline in implementing the protocols is what can prevent COVID-19 from spreading by paying attention to the protocols. So also another point that he wanted to put across was jobs as influencers, our jobs as people who can influence others are to give optimism to each other rather than give each other negative statements. So he also stated that if our souls, like if from inside of us are already pessimistic, then that can also have an effect on our health itself. But if we are optimistic, then that can also have a positive effect on our health. So thank you to Dr. Khairul Rahman. I would also like to conclude today's webinar by giving a big thank you to both of our panelists today, Dr. Putrisari and also Dr. Khairul Rahman. We would like to give our greatest gratitude for your materials, for your presentation today, and also for your very insightful answers for the question and answer today. We believe that we did have a very fruitful discussion, and we are very thankful once again to have both panelists with us today. And also on behalf of OIC Youth Indonesia and also the MOIC series that is going to take place in Indonesia, we would also like to remind the participants that there will also be other webinars regarding the other councils that will be available in MOIC. So please be on the lookout for those. And once again, thank you very much for attending tonight's webinar. That will be all from me. Thank you. I would like to personally ask for forgiveness if there were any mistakes along my journey of being the moderator for today. Thank you once again, and good night to everyone wherever you may be. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Waalaikumsalam.